Almighty, ever-living God, who as an example of humility for the human race to follow, caused our Savior to take flesh and submit to the cross, graciously grant that we may heed his lesson of patient suffering and so merit a share in his resurrection, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever. Amen.
A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. The Lord God has given me a well-trained tongue, that I might know how to speak to the weary, a word that will rouse them. Morning after morning, he opens my ear that I may hear, and have not rebelled, have not turned back. I gave my back to those who beat me, my cheeks to those who plucked my beard. My face I did not shield from buffets and spitting. The Lord God is my help, therefore I am not disgraced. I have set my face like flint, knowing that I shall not be put to shame. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Why have you abandoned? midst of the assembly, I will praise you. You who fear the Lord, praise him. All you descendants of Jacob, give glory to him. Revere him, all you descendants of Israel. My God, my God, why have you abandoned me?
A reading from the letter of St. Paul's to the Philippians. Christ Jesus, though he was in the form of God, did not regard equality with God something to be grasped. Rather, he emptied himself, taking the form of a slave, coming in human likeness, and found human in appearance. He humbled himself, becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Because of this, God greatly exalted him and bestowed on him the name which is above every name, that in the name of Jesus, every knee shall bend, of those in the heaven and on earth and under the earth. And every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Mark.
Glory.
The Passover and the Feast of Unleavened Bread were to take place in 2 days' time. So the chief priests and the scribes were seeking a way to arrest him by treachery and put him to death. They said, when he was in Bethany reclining at table in the house of Simon the leper, a woman came with an alabaster jar of perfumed oil, costly genuine spikenard. She broke the alabaster jar and poured it on his head. There were some who were indignant. they were infuriated with her, Jesus said,
"Let her alone. Why do you make trouble for her? She has done a good thing for me. The poor you will always have with you, and whenever you wish, you can do good for them, but you will not always have me. She has done what she could. She has anticipated anointing my body for burial. Amen, I say to you, wherever the gospel is proclaimed to the whole world, what she has done will be told in memory of her."
Then Judas Iscariot, one of the 12, went off to the chief priests to hand him over to them. When they heard him, they were pleased and promised to pay him money. Then he looked for an opportunity to hand him over. On the first day of the feast of unleavened bread, when they sacrificed the Passover lamb, his disciples said to him, "He sent two of his disciples and said to them,
'Go into the city, and a man will meet you carrying a jar of water. Follow him. Wherever he enters, say to the master of the house, the teacher says, where is my guest room where I may eat the Passover with my disciples? Then he will show you a large upper room, furnished and ready. Make the preparations for us there.'"
The disciples then went off, entered the city, and found it just as he had told them, and they prepared the Passover. When it was evening, he came with the 12, and as they reclined at table and were eating, Jesus said,
"Amen, I say to you, one of you will betray me, one who is eating with me."
They began to be distressed and say to him one by one,
"Surely it is not I."
He said to them,
"One of the 12, the one who dips with me into the dish, for the Son of Man indeed goes, as it is written of him, but woe to that man by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. It would be better for that man if he had never been born."
While they were eating, he took bread and said the blessing, broke it, and gave it to them and said,
"Take it, this is my body."
Then he took a cup, gave thanks, and gave it to them, and they all drank from it. He said to them,
"This is my blood of the covenant, which will be shed for many. Amen, I say to you, I shall not drink again the fruit of the vine until the day when I drink it new in the kingdom of God."
Then, after singing a hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives. Then Jesus said to them,
"All of you will have your faith shaken, for it is written, I will strike the shepherd, and the sheep will be dispersed. But after I have been raised up, I shall go before you to Galilee."
Peter said to him,
"Even though all should have their faith shaken, mine will not be."
Then Jesus said to him,
"Amen, I say to you, this very night, before the cock crows twice, you will deny me three times."
But he vehemently replied,
"Even though I should have to die with you, I will not deny you."
And they all spoke similarly. Then they came to a place named Gethsemane, and he said to his disciples,
"Sit here while I pray."
He took with him Peter, James, and John, and he began to be troubled and distressed. Then he said to them,
"My soul is sorrowful even to death. Remain here and keep watch."
He advanced a little and fell to the ground and prayed that if it were possible, the hour might pass him by. He said,
"Abba, Father, all things are possible to you. Take this cup away from me, but not what I will, but what you will."
When he returned, he found them asleep. He said to Peter,
"Simon, are you asleep? Could you not keep watch for 1 hour? Watch and pray that you may not undergo the test. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak.
Withdrawing again, he prayed, saying the same thing. Then he returned once more and found them asleep, for they could not keep their eyes open and did not know what to answer him. He returned a third time and said to them,
"Are you still sleeping and taking your rest? It is enough. The hour has come. Behold, the Son of Man is to be handed over to sinners. Get up, let us go. See, my betrayer is at hand."
Then, while he was still speaking, Judas, one of the 12, arrived, accompanied by a crowd with swords and clubs, who had come from the chief priests, the scribes, and the elders. His betrayer had arranged a signal with them, saying,
"The man I shall kiss is the one. Arrest him and lead him away securely."
He came and immediately went over to him and said,
"Rabbi."
And he kissed him. At this, they laid hands on him and arrested him. One of the bystanders drew his sword, struck the high priest's servant, and cut off his ear. Jesus said to them in reply,
"Have you come out as against a robber with swords and clubs to seize me? Day after day I was with you, teaching in the temple area, yet you did not arrest me, but that the scriptures may be fulfilled."
And they all left him and fled. Now a young man followed him, wearing nothing but a linen cloth about his body. They seized him, but he left the cloth behind and ran off naked. They led Jesus away to a high priest, and all the chief priests and the elders and the scribes came together. Peter followed him at a distance into the high priest's courtyard and was seated with the guards, warming himself at the fire. The chief priests and the entire Sanhedrin kept trying to obtain testimony against Jesus in order to put him to death, but they found none. Many gave false witness against him, but their testimony did not agree. Some took the stand and testified falsely against him, alleging,
"We heard him say,
Even so, their testimony did not agree. The high priest rose before the assembly and questioned Jesus, saying,
"Have you no answer? What are these men testifying against you?"
But he was silent and answered nothing. Again, the high priest asked him and said to him,
"Are you the Christ, the Son of the Blessed One?"
Then Jesus answered,
"I am, and you will see the Son of Man seated at the right hand of the power, and coming with the clouds of heaven."
At that, the high priest tore his garments and said,
"What further need have we of witnesses? You have heard the blasphemy. What do you think?"
They all condemned him as deserving to die. Some began to spit on him. They blindfolded him and struck him and said to him,
"Prophesy."
And the guards greeted him with blows. While Peter was below in the courtyard, one of the high priest's maids came along. Seeing Peter warming himself, she looked intently at him and said, but he denied it, saying,
"I neither know nor understand what you are talking about."
So we went out to the outer court. Then the cock crowed. The maids saw him and began to again to say to the bystanders, "This man is one of them." Oops. Once again, he denied it. A little later, the bystanders said to Peter once more, he began to curse and to swear,
"I do not know this man about whom you are talking."
And immediately a cock crowed a second time. Then Peter remembered the word that Jesus said to him,
"Are you the King of the Jews?"
No. He broke down and wept. As soon as the morning came, the chief priests with the elders and the scribes, that is the whole Sanhedrin, held a council. They bound Jesus, led him away, and handed him over to Pilate. Pilate questioned him,
"Are you the King of the Jews?"
He said to him in reply,
"You say so."
The chief priests accused him of many things. Again, Pilate questioned him,
"Have you no answer See how many things they accuse you of?
Jesus gave him no further answer, so Pilate was amazed. Now on the occasion of the feast, he used to release them one prisoner whom they requested. A man called Barabbas was then in prison, along with the rebels who had committed murder and a rebellion. The crowd came forward and began to ask him to do for them as he was accustomed. Pilate answered,
Do you want me to release to you the King of the Jews?
For he knew that it was out of envy that the chief priests had handed him over. But the chief priests stirred up the crowd to have them release Barabbas for them instead. Pilate again said to them in reply,
Then what do you want me to do with the man you call King of the Jews?
They shouted again,
Crucify him.
Pilate said to them,
Why? What evil has he done?
They shouted only the louder. So Pilate, wishing to satisfy the crowd, released Barabbas to them, and after he had Jesus scourged, handed him over to be crucified. The soldiers led him away inside the palace, that is, the praetorium, and the assembled whole cohort. They clothed him in purple, and weaving a crown of thorns, placed it on him. They began to salute him with, and kept striking his head with a reed and spitting upon him. They knelt before him in homage. And when they not mocked him, they stripped him of the purple cloak, dressed him in his own clothes, and led him out to crucify him. They pressed into service a passerby, Simon, a Cyrenian, who was coming in from the country, the father of Alexander and Rufus, to carry his cross. They brought him to the place of Golgotha, which is translated place of the skull. They gave him wine drugged with myrrh, but he did not take it. Then they crucified him and divided his garments, by casting lots for them to see what each should take. It was 9 o'clock in the morning when they had crucified him. The inscription of the charge against him read, With him they crucified two revolutionaries, one on his right and one on his left. Those passing by reviled him, shaking their heads and saying, Likewise, the chief priests with the scribes mocked him among themselves and said, Those who were crucified with him also kept abusing him. At noon, darkness came over the whole land until 3 p.m. And at 3 o'clock, Jesus cried out in a loud voice,
Eloi, Eloi, lema sabachthani,
which is translated,
my God, why have you forsaken me?
Some of the bystanders who heard it said, One of them ran, soaked a sponge with wine, put it on a reed and gave it to him to drink, saying,
Wait, let us see if Elijah comes to take him down.
Jesus gave a loud cry and breathed his last. The veil of the sanctuary was torn in two from top to bottom. When the centurion who stood facing him saw how he breathed his last, he said,
Truly, this man was the Son of God.
There were also women looking on from a distance. Among them were Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of the younger James of Joseph, and Salome. These women had followed him when he was in Galilee and ministered to him. There were also many other women who had come up with him to Jerusalem. When it was already evening, since it was a day of preparation, the day before the Sabbath, Joseph of Arimathea, a distinguished member of the council, who was himself awaiting the kingdom of God, came and courageously went to Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus. Pilate was amazed that he was already dead. He summoned the centurion and asked him if Jesus had already died. And when he learned of it from the centurion, he gave the body to Joseph. Having bought a linen cloth, he took him down, wrapped him in the linen cloth, and laid him in a tomb that had been hewn out of rock. Then he rolled a stone against the entrance of the tomb. Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of Joseph, washed where he was laid.
The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
We begin these magnificent days before us, we call Holy Week. And as we read the Passion, both on this Passion Palm Sunday and on Good Friday, as we enter into these most sacred and most beautiful liturgies, we celebrate on Monday the Chrism Mass, where the priests will renew their vows, their priestly vows, before Bishop Amos, who returns as our retired bishop. We think of all of these things that are before us, and what is most significant, it seems, is the phrase Holy Week. How am I, each of us individually, how am I going to make this week holy? Stories, the liturgies, all of the things are beautiful. Some we will be able to attend, some because of work or whatever reason, we will not. But nonetheless, we are to make this week holy in our lives. We hear of the love of Christ on the cross, how he lovingly offers his very life for our sins, not for any sin he has committed, for our sins, he offers his very life. What do we offer in return? How do we make this week holy? How does it become a blessed event in our lives where we understand his life, his death, and his resurrection as this beautiful salvific event for all of us? It is my prayer and it is my desire that all of us make the effort to make this week holy. May we celebrate all that he has done for us, all that he has offered for us on that cross. May it be a beautiful, beautiful time where the events, the stories, and the liturgies come to life, and we celebrate the beauty as it unfolds these days ahead. May you have the most blessed of holy weeks. Let us stand and together profess our faith. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Together we share our needs with the Lord, who humbled himself to be one with us.
Spirit may sanctify the church in her observations of this solemn week, we pray to the Lord. That God's exaltation of the name of Jesus may bring people of all nations to their knees, we pray to the Lord. That God may not abandon the distressed, the dying, or those sentenced to death, we pray to the Lord. That Jesus may journey together with us through experiences of loss and sacrifice, we pray to the Lord. For Julia and Robert Tigges, for all those faithful departed, all the intentions listed in our book of prayers, and for all of our own intentions, we pray to the Lord.
Lord God, hear these prayers and petitions that we bring before you with humble hearts, and answer them in accordance with your holy will. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Amen. This time I invite all of our children who have written some special deed they have done or have brought their offering to bring it forward to the altar.
Our offertory hymn is number 485 in the music issue. What Wondrous Love Is This, number 485.
Thank you.
To bear the dreadful curse for my soul. For
Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and the good of all, Holy Church. Through the passion of your only begotten Son, O Lord, may our reconciliation with you be near at hand, so that though we do not merit it by our own deeds, yet by this sacrifice made once for all, we may feel already the effects of your mercy through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere, to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For though innocent, he suffered willingly for sinners and accepted unjust condemnation to save the guilty. His death has washed away our sins, and his resurrection has purchased our justification. And so with all the angels, we praise you, as in joyful celebration, we acclaim. You are indeed holy, O Lord, and all you have created rightly gives you praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy, and you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me."
And
the mystery of faith. Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be, as we look forward to his second coming, and offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you willed to reconcile us to yourself, grant that we who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son and filled with his Holy Spirit may become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, with Saint Terebius, and with all the saints, on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth with your servant, Francis, our Pope, the Order of Bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family, whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. Remember your servants, Julia and Robert Tigas, whom you have called from this world to yourself. Grant that they who were united with your Son in a death like his may also be one with him in his resurrection, when from the earth he will raise up in the flesh those who have died and transform our lowly body after the pattern of his own glorious body. To our departed brothers and sisters too, and to all who were pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory, when you will wipe away every tear from our eyes. For seeing you, our God, as you are, we shall be like you for all the ages and praise you without end through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always. Let us offer each other some sign of Christ's peace. Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
Our communion hymn can be found in the music issue, number 154, O Sacred Head Surrounded, number 154.
Oh,
Second communion hymn is number 472. There is a balm in Gilead, number 472.
Let us pray. Nourished with these sacred gifts, we humbly beseech you, O Lord, that just as through the death of your Son, you have brought us hope for what we believe, so by the resurrection, you may lead us to where you call, through Christ our Lord. Stay right there. Just a couple of announcements. Remember that all of the services are in the bulletin. They are in there a couple of spots under my article. It has all of the times and dates. Also, the Chrism Mass is mentioned. We do welcome back because we don't have our own bishop currently, and a bishop must be there to consecrate the sacred chrism. We do welcome back Bishop Amos, our Bishop Emeritus, and so that will be a wonderful experience. All of those times and dates you can find in the bulletin. Please also note that Ignite Sunday is this weekend. They begin with a meal at 5:30, and the program is at 6:10. It is the seven last words of Christ. Please note there is no 4:30 Mass because of Palm Sunday. No Mass this weekend because of Palm Sunday. We do keep in our hearts and our prayers you, Irene, and your brother Denny at the loss of your mother. I was just brand new here when we had our picture taken for her 99th birthday. So know of our love and prayers and the passing of your mother after 99 years of wonderful life. Our prayers are with you. The Lord be with you. Bow down for the blessing. Look, we pray, O Lord, on this your family, for whom our Lord Jesus Christ did not hesitate to be delivered into the hands of the wicked and submit to the agony of the cross, who lives and reigns forever and ever. Amen. And may Almighty God bless you, the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Go forth, the Mass is ended.
As we go forth, we'll sing number 159, Were You There, number 159 in the music issue.